In our study of the book of Hosea, we are entering a new section which magnifies the love of God. In fact, it is the message of love that dominates the book of Hosea. We have been thinking so far of the unfaithfulness and the failure of the people of Israel. But that is not the chief message of this book. It is true that here we see God's people going astray. Like Hosea's wife who went astray, they too have become unfaithful. They went astray in many ways. We have studied the causes of unfaithfulness and how God's faithfulness was grieved. We have also seen how they have suffered the consequences of their unfaithfulness. We saw how God's faithfulness chastened them. Now we are going to look at the cure of their unfaithfulness. God's faithfulness acts. God's love acts. It does not sit passively and silently as his people go astray. That is the picture we see here of a seeking love, the picture of a restoring, redeeming love. And I pray that this will become a real blessing to us. That is the message of Christmas. God sent his Son to seek after the sinners so that they can be restored. Let us look at the nature of this love. Our God is holy and righteous. The Bible is very clear about it. In many places we read God saying, I am holy, so be ye holy. Look at Peter's first letter, chapter 1 and verse 15. 1 Peter 1:15. As he who called you is holy, be holy yourselves in all your conduct, since it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. How clearly God says here that holiness is his basic nature, his quality. And then we notice in Leviticus chapter 11, where God was trying to teach his people about his holiness. He says this in verse 44, I am the Lord your God. Consecrate yourselves therefore and be holy, for I am holy. Again he says in verse 45 of Leviticus 11, For I am the Lord who brought you up out of the land of Egypt to be your God. You shall therefore be holy, for I am holy. He certainly is a holy God, a righteous God. That is why he acts against sin. His very moral character moves him to act against sin. The Bible speaks about the wrath of God. We read about the wrath of God in Romans chapter 1. Let us turn to verse 18 of this chapter. The wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and wickedness of men who by their wickedness suppress the truth. Turn again to Ephesians and chapter 2. We notice here that we are the children of wrath, verse 3. Among these, we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, following the desires of body and mind, and so we were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. How do you understand God's wrath? There are those who say that this is the impersonal principle of retribution that is at work in this universe. It is true that there is the law of retribution. God's word says, whatsoever a man sows, that he shall reap. But remember, it is not an impersonal law of retribution. It is the attitude, the personal attitude of our God towards sin that is described by the expression, the wrath of God. It is his settled personal attitude to sin, which results in judgment for those who sin. God will punish sin. But he is also the God of love. We read in scripture in 1 John chapter 4 and verse 8, God is love. How can we reconcile these two facts, these two truths? On the one side, God is holy and righteous, therefore he must punish sin. On the other side, he is the God of love, so he must redeem them and restore them. He cannot give them up. This is the dilemma that is posed in the book of Hosea. Hosea was close to the heart of God. He could understand God's love because he himself had experienced the treachery and the betrayal that happened to him. His wife had turned against him. She was unfaithful to him. She betrayed him. At the same time, he loved her. He could not give her up. So in that dilemma, he could understand the heart of God and the dilemma that God faced. That is why we read in Hosea chapter 11 and verse 8. God says, "How can I give you up, O Ephraim? How can I hand you over, O Israel? How can I make you like Adma? How can I treat you like Zeboim? My heart recoils within me. My compassion grows warm and tender." We should understand what is meant by the names Adma and Zeboim. We find the explanation in Genesis chapter 14. These are the names of cities that were located in the plain of Jordan. We read in Genesis chapter 14 and verse 1 and 2. In the days of Amraphel, king of Shinar, Arioch, king of Elasar, Kedorlaomer, king of Elam, and Tidal, king of Goim, these kings made war with Bera, king of Sodom, Birsha, king of Gomorrah, Shinab, king of Adma, Shemeber, king of Zeboim, and the king of Bela, that is Zoar. Did you notice the names of those cities in the Jordan Valley? Sodom, Gomorrah, Adma, Zeboim, and Bela. So Adma and Zeboim are linked with Sodom and Gomorrah in this verse. God's judgment came upon those cities. They were utterly destroyed. They were forsaken. God says now here to his people, "How can I treat you like them? I cannot give you up like they were given up." And then he says, "My heart is stirred within me. My compassion grows warm and tender." Here is where we see the heart of God. It is breaking and aching over the sin of man. Do you know this, my friend? When you have gone away from him and his purpose, when your life is not used for his purposes, when we live a sinful, selfish life, God is concerned. His heart is aching, and that is his love. Let us look at the nature of this love further. The Old Testament speaks of two activities of God in connection with love. First is his election, and the second is his covenant. God elects his people. He enters into a covenant with them. Look at Hosea chapter 11 and verse 1. We find here God's election. "When Israel was a child, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son." Why did God call Israel? Why did he choose Israel? Not because they merited it, but it is purely because of his love. That is his election love. We read about this in Deuteronomy chapter 7. Let us look at that verse, Deuteronomy chapter 7 and verse 6. "You are a people holy to the Lord your God. The Lord your God has chosen you to be a people for his own possession out of all the peoples that are on the face of the earth." Notice now in verse 7, "It was not because you were more in number than any other people that the Lord set his love upon you and chose you, for you were the fewest of all peoples." So God did not choose them because they merited it or because they had anything, but because of his love. In Amos chapter 3 and verse 2 we read, "You only have I known, or have I chosen, of all the families of the earth. Therefore I'll punish you for all your iniquities." Election implies a responsibility and a privilege. There is not only the privilege that God has chosen his people out of all other peoples, but there is also the responsibility. If they fail him, he would punish them. That is implied in his election. And then in Hosea chapter 11 verses 3 and 4, we notice how God enters into a relationship with his people because of his covenant. God enters into a covenant, and therefore he is in relationship with his people. That is the second thing we notice about his love. He not only chooses us, he is also in relationship with us. How wonderful it is to realize this. Do you know that God has not chosen you because you merited it? He chose us in spite of our unworthiness. He chose us in spite of our sinfulness. And then he enters into a relationship with us. Look at this relationship in Hosea 11, 3 and 4. "It was I who taught Ephraim to walk. I took them up in my arms, but they did not know that I healed them. I led them with cords of compassion, with the bands of love, and I became to them as one who eases the yoke on their jaws, and I bent down to them and fed them. In the first part of this verse 3, you notice God is compared to the Father. So the relationship is that between the Father and the Son. In verse 1, when Israel was a child, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son. And then that father taught Ephraim to walk, the love between the Father and the Son. Then in that same verse, I took them up in my arms, the relationship between the mother and child. Yes, God's love is not only like the Father's love, it is also like the mother's love. And then, they did not know that I healed them. It is the relationship between the physician and the patient, the sick person. God says, I healed them. And then the relationship between the husband and the wife, or the lover and the loved one. I led them with cords of compassion, with the bands of love. Notice God talks about the cords of love, the cords of kindness. Yes, that is the relationship between a husband and wife. And then the end of verse 4. I became to them as one who eases the yoke on their jaws, and I bent down to them and fed them. The relationship between the cattle herd and the cattle, the one who takes care of the cattle and the cattle. In all of this, you see the concern of God, the care of God, and his love. Yes, God loves us as a father loves his son, as a mother loves her child, as the physician cares for his patient, as the husband or the lover loves the wife or the loved one, as a cattle herd cares for his cattle, God cares for us. This is the nature of his love. And that is how the relationship that God has with us is portrayed. But this love was spurned. The story of the failure of God's people is a story of love that has been spurned. Is this not true even with us? In spite of all the love that God has manifested towards us, yet we harden our hearts and turn our backs on him. We are not faithful to do what he wants us to do. God wants us to be a blessing to others. He wants us to care for those who are lost without the Savior. He wants us to share his burden for those who have not heard the gospel. But we do not care. We have spurned his love, so we do not love others. Yet he does not give us up. Look further what the book of Hosea says about this love. It is free love. It does not depend on our righteousness or on our merit. God loves us freely. This is what grace is. In Hosea verse 4 of chapter 14, I will heal their faithlessness. I will love them freely, for my anger has turned from them. God says, I will love them freely. It is a love that is unmerited. Grace is defined by someone as the unmerited favor of God. How true this is. Then secondly, it is also redeeming love. The love of a Savior, of a Redeemer. Hosea 13 and verse 4. I am the Lord your God from the land of Egypt. You know no God but me, and besides me there is no Savior. Again, look at Hosea chapter 12 and verse 9. I am the Lord your God from the land of Egypt. I will again make you dwell in tents as in the days of the appointed feast. He reminded them of the great deliverance he worked out for them from their bondage in Egypt. He reminded them of their bondage in Egypt and that great deliverance because he wanted to show to them that he was their Redeemer, their Savior. The love is that of the Savior. It is God's redeeming love. It wants to lift us up, save us from our sins, and restore us to that relationship which he wants to have with us. And then it is also suffering love. The greatest sufferer in this universe is God the Father, with his heart of love. That's what someone has said. And how true it is. When man sins and suffers the consequences of his sin, it is God who suffers even more. Do you know that, my friend? When you suffer because of the consequences of your unfaithfulness, God suffers with you. It is true that we have problems in our family life, in our personal life. because of our self-will and the wrong decisions we have made, we suffer as a result. But God suffers even more. You find this in the book of Hosea, chapter 6 and verse 4. We have seen this verse many times. God says, "What shall I do with you, O Ephraim? What shall I do with you, O Judah?" This comes out of a heart of love, suffering, agonizing love. Then look at Hosea 11 and verse 8, where he says, "How can I give you up, O Ephraim? How can I hand you over, O Israel? My heart recoils within me. My compassion grows warm and tender." How wonderful it is to know that God does not live in detached bliss, unconcerned about our suffering. But He is concerned about our suffering. He suffers along with us. This is the nature of His love. It's a love that will not let us go. Look at Romans chapter 5 and verses 6 and 8. "While we were yet helpless, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly." God shows His love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Notice those expressions. While we were yet helpless, while we were yet sinners, God did not love us because we deserved His love. When we had nothing to offer, yet He loved us. And it is this love that will restore us. How wonderful it is to realize this love. Will you open your heart to this love?